Good morning. Welcome one and all to this time of worship together here this morning. This is the day the Lord has given us, and it is good to be here together and worshiping. It is one of those mornings where you get to choose what state you live in. If you live in the state of Michigan, about a half an hour ago, there was almost blizzard-like conditions. If you live in the state of denial, it's a lovely spring morning. Whatever state you're in, we come to gather in worship together. It may be that you're in a state of joy and rejoicing this day, this week. Maybe that you're in some state of bearing a heavy burden or concern, but whatever state we find ourselves in, we come to worship the Lord, and we hear his call to worship together this morning. Rita is going to lead us in words calling us to worship, Jesus' words calling us to worship and follow him. Why don't you rise as able as we join in these words together.
Our call to worship comes from Matthew 16. Jesus asked his disciples, "What about you? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter confessed, You
are the Messiah, the Son of the living God."
Jesus explained to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. And he said to them,
"Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul?" We come to hear and heed again Jesus' call to follow him, to take up our cross, to make his life the shape of our life, to make his death our true opening to life with him forevermore. So receive his greeting this day. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the abundant fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Amen. Come, let's worship God together in song.
This place a new light is shining. Now is the darkness vanished away. See, in this space our fears and our dreamings brought you to you in the light of this day. Gather us in the lost and forsaken. Gather us in the blind and the lame. Call to us now and we shall awaken. We shall arise at the sound of your name. We are the young, our lives are a mystery. We are the old who yearn for your face. We have been sung throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. Gather us in the rich and the haughty. Gather us in the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so meek and so lowly. Give us the courage to enter the song. Not in the dark of buildings confining, not in some heaven light years away. Here in this place the new light is shining. Now is the kingdom and now is the day. Gather us in and hold us forever. Gather us in and make us your own. Gather us in, all peoples together, fire of love in our flesh and our bones. Worthy of every song sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could sing, worthy of all the praise.
The words of Jesus from John 3 call us to confession today. Jesus said, "This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." Heeding this call, let us sing, "I want to walk as a child of the light."
I want to walk as a child of the light. I want to follow Jesus. God sent the stars to give light to the world.
This call, as we have sung, "I want to walk as a child of the light," we come to the prayer of confession. O Father of the heavenly lights, you do not change like shifting shadows, and yet there is so much darkness in this world and in us. People love darkness instead of light. And sometimes we are people like that. Yet we confess that we are slow to bring our lives into your searching and cleansing light. We confess that our prideful thoughts, our dishonest way, our cruel words obscure the light. We confess that we often avoid the hard but right path, the way of forgiveness, generosity, and prayer. Only by your grace and with your spirit can we truly do so. So hear our prayer, Lord, and renew our walk as we sing and pray.
To see the brightness of God, I want to look at Jesus. His Son of righteousness shine on my path and show me the way to the Father. In Him there is no darkness at all.
John 3, there is an assurance of pardon and a call to holy living. Hear the good news. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him.
Good morning. Our offerings this morning are for Kelvin Theological Seminary and the various ministries of Shawnee Park. Kelvin Theological Seminary is a learning community in the Reformed Christian tradition that serves the Christian Reformed Church in North America. They prepare individuals for biblically faithful, effective ministry of the Word by offering Reformed theological scholarship and counsel. As you give your gifts this morning, consider how you can support the work of Kelvin Theological Seminary, as well as Shawnee Park and its community in the coming weeks and months ahead. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning to pray for the various ministries of Shawnee Park Christian Reformed Church, as well as Kelvin Seminary. We thank you, dear Father, for bringing us together and providing the resources for these offerings. We pray that we may do things that are well-pleasing in your sight, and that we be good stewards of these resources to further your kingdom. We pray for the staff, professors, and teachers as they provide leadership and the skill set needed for a new generation of church leaders throughout our global community. Please, Lord, be with all those in need, wherever they may be. For Jesus' sake, amen.
We're going to continue in a time of prayer, coming before God and praying for needs of the church and the world. I'm noting in prayer a couple of things that may or may not be on your radar screen, so I'll just note them ahead of time. One is there was a report of kidnapping in Nigeria of 300 school children. There have been a few of these instances over recent years, and we want to pray for the people of that land. It was also noted in the news this week, and that would have passed me by otherwise, but this week marked 4 years since the beginning of the COVID pandemic really sort of hitting for us and changing life in North America, and it seemed worthy to pray about that, which in one way feels like about a couple decades ago, and another way feels very recent. But good to mention those things as well as other needs in prayer. Let's join our hearts and go to God together. O Holy Heavenly Father, we pray to you this day with faith, with fervent hope, with great and growing love. We come to you in prayer that our faith might grow, our hope might be stronger, our love might be more keen and focused throughout our prayer and our worship this day. O gracious God, we do pray to you in faith. Already in this hour of worship, we have sung so much of what we believe, that we want to be children of light, that we want to be gathered in, that we want to have our lives built on Jesus Christ and his love. It's because we believe in you by faith that we pray and sing these things. In faith, we believe that it is you who has called us and gathered us together into this time of worship. It's by faith that we thank you for the desire you've created in us to know you and worship you. It's by faith that we trust in Jesus Christ. We thank you that through him you have proclaimed to us a way of salvation, a new way of life that truly sets us free. And it's by faith that we believe you have called us to follow him and also to pray for the needs of the church and the world. We pray for the needs of in our own congregation, for those especially who have medical concerns at present. We pray for Jovan Manon that she would recover from this hospitalization this week and grow daily in strength. We continue our prayers for Mary Jane Van Loo, that she would experience good recovery from the surgery, that the chemotherapy working in her body would prove effective, that you would give her patience with the discomforts and the difficulties of this journey. We continue our prayers for Craig Vandervlies and for Carol Kuipers and for Dee Holden and for others who daily face difficulties of health. Father, we recognize this week, 4 years since that COVID pandemic began and shifted life in so many ways for such a period of time. We remember and recall with some degree of surprise and wonder and fear again how quickly the world can change right underneath our feet, how quickly our schedules and calendars, our to-do lists can all be altered and affected. Lord, we grieve what resulted in terms of the sickness and illness of many people, the loss of lives. We grieve so much of what was lost of meaningful gatherings, of weddings and graduations and parties. We grieve some of the changes that came as we faced these things and had such deep disagreements about how best to handle them throughout culture and in the church as well. We remember with a kind of desire to forget all that has transpired. Yet we thank you, too, for providentially seeing us through, for the good and faithful work of doctors and nurses and scientists and caregivers. We thank you for the many ways that love for neighbor was put on display through just a terribly difficult season. And we continue to pray that you would uphold us and guard us and keep us in this troubled world. We pray for other troubles in this world as well. We pray for the ongoing violence that has occurred in Haiti. We pray that you would deliver the men, women, and children of that land from the reign of gang violence. We pray for good governance and the restoration of peace and fair law. We pray, O God, for the peoples of Ukraine and Israel and Gaza and Myanmar who continue to experience the ravages of distress and war. And we pray for the kidnapping of these children in Nigeria. O Lord, you are the one who frees captives. And we pray that those who've been taken would be returned to their families and homes, and that this regular terror would cease. Comfort those children and keep them safe from violence. We pray for their safe release, and that those who do such things will repent and turn and be held to just account. Oh God, we offer these prayers in faith that you truly do hear our prayers, but we also pray in great hope. In your word is our hope. We are bold to hope that the good work you have begun in us, you will bring to completion. We are bold to hope that you will grow in us a more perfect holiness that reflects your character, that bears your light in a dark world. We hope that the salvation we have known in Christ will be known more and more, that friends and neighbors and family members and classmates will come to share with us what we have found in Christ Jesus. It is because we hope that you'll give us reason to give reason for the hope that is in us so that others too may see and know and believe and hope in Jesus' name. Oh God, we pray in faith, we pray in hope, and we pray in love. Let our love for you grow more and more in depth of insight and wisdom. We love you because you have first loved us. You've given us life and you have redeemed the broken things of our lives through the victory of Jesus' cross. May love more and more be what captures our thoughts and moves us and shapes us, Give us eyes to see the hurting, the vulnerable, and the oppressed, to in love work for justice, and in love to do mercy, and in love to perform the works of care and compassion, in love to speak the truth. O God, who inspires our faith, who fuels our hope, and who empowers our love, we worship you. And we ask that you hear and receive all these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to prepare then to open God's word together and hear from it. But first we're going to sing a song of preparation that anticipates the story we'll read, a parable of Jesus. Keep your lamps trimmed and burning. I invite you to rise as able as we sing. And with that, I invite you to turn, if you would, to Matthew chapter 25. It is on page 806 in the Pew Bibles. We're continuing what's been a series through Lent and a little before in the parables in the Gospel of Matthew that Jesus tells, focusing in Lent, especially on the parables that Jesus tells in the final days of his life before his arrest, his trial, his crucifixion, and his resurrection. Today that brings us to this parable, Matthew chapter 25. Hear the word of the Lord. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom! Come out to meet him!" Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly, tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we've seen how Jesus in these parables, throughout his parables, is using parables to communicate. He uses parables in all kinds of interesting ways, sometimes to incite, and sometimes to invite, sometimes to provoke, sometimes to reveal, and sometimes to conceal. And we've seen a number of parables over recent weeks, going back a few weeks now. We saw a parable of a father with two both kind of lousy sons, and a parable about a landowner with some pretty lousy and violent and resistant servants. And we saw a parable about a king who wanted to throw a wedding for his son and a bunch of really lousy guests in one way or another. And one of the key points in this parable is this opening phrase, at that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like. And the significance there is that many of these parables so far have been focused on the past, on the story of God and God's people through the Old Testament, through the story of God with his people, Israel, leading right up to the present moment of the coming of Jesus, and how reactions then have prepared and are reflective of the actions now in responding to Jesus. But this parable is taking a different angle on things. It's beginning not from a past, a back-looking way, but it's looking more towards a future. And at that time, not the kingdom of heaven is like in the now, but the kingdom of heaven will be like. It's a future-oriented parable, looking back on the present moment, but from the perspective of the future rather than of the past. And that's significant because the previous chapter, some of the passage we've passed over to go to these next parables, has been where Jesus has been talking about a future day. A future day, a glorious future day, not about his first coming, this moment where he's preaching and teaching in Jerusalem and soon to be arrested and killed, but about a future glorious day when, as he says, the Son of Man will come on the clouds of heaven in power and great glory. So the previous parables have been about looking back, reinterpreting Israel's history in light of Jesus' coming, but now this parable is looking back on the present in the light of Jesus' future coming in glory. That's what this parable is about. The kingdom of heaven at that time, and what is it that Jesus, through this parable, intends us to know, to believe, to do in the now of our lives in light of that great and glorious future day. You've played a game probably as a child where someone would count to 10 or 20 or 100 and then shout, "Ready or not, here I come." And in a way, that's a decent slogan for this parable, "Ready or not." Ready or not, here I come. Will we be ready or not? And so there's three things I really want to reflect on with you. One, kind of briefly, this midnight cry, something about the timing of this future coming. But then especially on these virgins or these bridesmaids, and what is it, just what is it, what we're supposed to learn from this somewhat odd parable. And then thirdly, that last instruction of Jesus to keep watch, and what might that mean for us? So firstly, this cry at midnight, what we cannot and what we must know about the timing. What is it that we must know? What is it that we cannot know? It's worth noticing that just before this, Jesus has given a very short little parable about a faithful and wise servant and a wicked servant, and how they behave when their master is away from the household. And the message there was something like, hey, watch out. The master who's gone away might return sooner than you think. You never know. He might return at any time, so don't just presume he's going to be away for a long time. And just after that, Jesus tells this parable about these five bridesmaids,
five wise and five foolish, and it's kind of the flip side of that previous parable. The previous one was, watch out, he might come sooner than you think, and the message in this one seems to be, hey, you never know, he might take longer than you think, too. It could be any moment. Could be this one, could be the next one, but it could also be a long, long way off. The main teaching that's at the core of both of those, of course, is what Jesus says. He says, you do not know the day or the hour. You do not know. You cannot know the day or the hour. And it's important for you to know that you do not know and that you cannot know the day or the hour. There was a movie years back called Big Fish, and there was a scene in there where these children were kind of confronted with this witch-like figure who could tell you when and how you were going to die. And the question was, well, if you could know, would you want to know? If you could know exactly on what day and in what way you were going to die, would you want to know? It's kind of an interesting thing to ponder. I mean, presumably, all of us in this room, very likely, if the Lord tarries, are going to die. Would you want to know, if you could know, that it might be tomorrow, that it might be a month from now, that it might be 10 or 20 or 40 or 60 years from now? Would you want to know the day and the hour and the time of your death? I mean, it's good to wonder a little bit. It's natural to wonder a little bit when we might die and how. But of course, it's one of those things that we just do not know and cannot know. And it's probably good, for the most part, that we don't know that. It's good to wonder about it because it's good to realize, like, well, life can be pretty short. It could be any day. And yet it's good to not be too preoccupied by the timing question. Because at times, if we presume it's right away and right around the corner, we might make some kind of dumb decisions. We might fail to do some long-term planning. We might fail to buy life insurance, for example. Or we might hurry out and buy some, I suppose. That'd be another way to go at it. Long-term planning, short-term planning, you have to kind of plan for the long-term in life, even as you realize life might be short. And there seems to be something like this message, too, about not only our own individual story's final chapter and closing page, but the world's final chapter and closing page, that you do not know and cannot know where it will be. And so you don't have to fret too much about this. This isn't a situation where you can skip to the end of the book and read the last chapter first, exactly. You'll know some things about it from Jesus and his teaching, but the timing is one thing you specifically cannot know. You won't get ready for that future day by being endlessly preoccupied by the timing itself. You sometimes see, there's cartoons of this. Sometimes maybe you see it out on the street corners of someone holding a sandwich board saying, the end is near. And on the one hand, you kind of respect the urgency. On the other hand, you want to say the end could be near in light of Jesus' parable. I mean, it could be near and the end could be far away. If we're to follow Jesus, it's going to be some balance of urgency and also long-term planning that's going to have to be our approach. The cry comes up at midnight. You never know when it's going to come. Will you be ready or not? So that's the first thing, and I don't dwell on it too long, but that's one important point. The second one is this odd wedding party. What are we supposed to learn from these bridesmaids? This is let's just call it an odd parable. It is odd. It strikes us as odd as readers in various ways. It is, first of all, culturally odd to us. What kind of strange wedding is this? Some of the oddness for us is the distance we are in culture from this moment. First of all, these bridesmaids in the NAV here are called virgins. That's the more literal translation of the word. It's probably good not to get too hung up on that. It really is about young, unmarried women who are attendants of the bride and groom, much like a wedding party would be for us. And that this wedding is happening at the middle of the night would be very strange for us, but it might not be too uncommon in that day that there would be a festival or banquet or celebration that might carry on into the hours of darkness. I also read, I found this kind of helpful, that several commentators note that we might first think of a small little lamp, a little oil lamp, like a candle that you would light and put in your house, but that the lamps in this story might be more something like torches, something you would carry And what's especially significant about that is that a torch would burn through oil much faster than a little oil lamp. In fact, one commentator says maybe they would only have about 15 minutes of oil in them. So you'd have to continually replenish them, which is to say that for these bridesmaids, it would be sort of a common and expected thing that they would bring some reserve oil along. That what would happen is that when the bride or the groom or the groom and bride came, that you would join together in a great procession through the streets lit by these torches that would carry you through the streets, and there'd be singing and dancing and celebrating to accompany them on their wedding night. I mean, even in our culture, with all the details and planning around weddings, it's not unusual for something to get forgotten or neglected. I've been in a situation where the groomsmen forgot to bring a pair of black socks, and someone has to run to Myers because the white socks don't look so good with the black tuxes. Or maybe it would be something like, this might be a little closer to the parable, say the videographer brought along the camera and a battery pack, but no backup battery and no charging cord either, so that, well, by the time the wedding's ready to start, suddenly the battery light is blinking and flashing like it's about to die, and it would be a bit irresponsible to not bring a backup, right? I mean, those are some things that are culturally odd to us, but there are some others that even within the time and place of that culture and their wedding practices that the scholars note is odd even within that culture. So here's three of them. First of all, the groom's tardiness. There is something in this parable of a surprising delay. It would be odd for a groom to come so late that these bridesmaids have to wait and wait, so much so that they just have to fall asleep. All of them fall asleep while waiting, and the cry comes up at midnight. There's something in this parable about an odd and unexpected timing. We've already talked about that, but that's an odd feature of this parable. Secondly, in this parable, not unlike the one we looked at a few weeks ago, there's never any mention of the bride. In that previous parable, there was a king looking who had a son getting married. So we had the groom, and we had the groom's father, and we had lots about in that parable about guests, but there was no bride ever mentioned. And that's worth wondering about, if that's intentional or deliberate in some way. And then thirdly, the way this parable ends, this flat rejection of the latecomers. That those who come, though they were bridesmaids, virgins, expected to be part of the wedding party, that because of their delay and their not having enough oil, that when they do arrive, the groom goes out and says, well, I'm sorry, the door is shut. Specifically, I never knew you. That is odd, even and especially within the culture. And that may be an invitation for us to see it, especially in the light of something Jesus taught earlier. So look at an earlier passage with me a moment from Matthew chapter 7. This is in the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. And you may catch, as you listen to that, several points of connection between that passage and the one we've just read. Specifically, the calling out, Lord, Lord, as the virgins, the bridesmaids do in verse 11. Lord, Lord, open the door for us. And that reference that this is what will happen on that day. In our parable, it's at that time. It's looking ahead to a future day. They're both future-oriented passages. And then, of course, that last phrase, I never knew you, or in our parable, I don't know you. That suggests that some things in this parable are odd, not only to us, living distant from them in time and place and culture, but would have been odd even to the original listeners, would have struck them as odd, and they would have needed to, well, consider them in light of Jesus' broader teaching. All of which prepares us to answer that question. What is it that we are supposed to especially learn from this contrast Jesus paints between the wise and the foolish, between the well and the properly prepared and the poorly prepared? Keeping the lamps or torches trimmed and lighted and having some oil in reserve, some proper preparation, what does that all represent? Well, it seems that something about having the lamp lit at all is to have some kind of a connection or relationship to Jesus. Notice that they call out, Lord, Lord, right? It's like these would be people who have made some kind of Christian commitment or confession. Jesus is Lord is kind of the most basic early Christian creed and confession. To say Jesus is Lord and not Caesar, Jesus is Lord, he's the ruler over my life, he's the king, is a core Christian confession. It's an important term, Lord. But Jesus' teaching here in Matthew 7, and then again in this parable, suggests that merely making that confession, merely having that outward identity as a Christ follower is not in itself sufficient. That would be to have a torch, a lamp, and to have it lit, but to have potentially no reserve. To have the reserve, what does it mean? To have the extra battery pack, to have the extra fuel on hand. That would be, much like Jesus says in Matthew 7, it would be to do the will of my Father who is in heaven. It would be to not merely outwardly identify as a Christian, as if you're presented with a number of lists on of items on a survey. What is your religious identity? You say, well, I'm not Buddhist, and I'm not a Muslim, and I guess I'm not really an atheist, but I'm Christian. I'm part of that general Christian category. Fine. But the real question is, do you put into practice the things that Jesus said? It's fairly meaningless to call Jesus Lord, to say, I'm a Christian, Jesus is my Lord, but to not actually take the things he has said and make him Lord of your life. The things Jesus has said about, well, living a life of prayer, about being a person of forgiveness for those who wrong you, about loving your neighbor and loving your enemy, about bringing your, well, your financial life under the lordship of Jesus so that you practice justice and you pursue generosity, even sacrificially in Jesus' name, that you bring your life financially, socially, sexually, all of your life and your body under the teaching of Jesus and seek to have it guided by Jesus' words and instructions. That would be to not only call Jesus Lord, Lord, but to be daily putting into practice this reserve, your reserves of oil that will keep your lamp trimmed and burning in Jesus' name. It is to go in not only for the outward confession to Jesus, but for the full treatment of Jesus shaping, guiding influence in your life. Practicing daily acts of discipleship. Pursuing faithfulness to the lordship of Jesus in all our various callings as wives and husbands and sisters and brothers, as children and parents, of students or of in workplaces, in our city and society, that in everything we do, we're looking to, well, let the lordship of Jesus rule and reign in us and through us. Daily discipleship, vocational faithfulness to Jesus. What Eugene Peterson had that book we looked at a couple years ago, A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. A faithfulness to Jesus through all the nitty-gritty common daily tasks and what we think, what we say, what we do. That would be to have reserves of oil, not merely a moment's confession or even a moment's experience of Jesus. Maybe sometime years ago I had an experience of Jesus and that's what really defines me as a Christian, but have I found a way to daily put that into practice, to draw that into what I think, say, and do? This is the best way to be ready for the bridegroom to come, to have your lamp trimmed and burning and to have reserves of oil that you can bring to be part of the great celebration of the wedding, the great joyful feast that is to come. The final instruction Jesus gives in verse 13 is therefore keep watch. You do not know the day or the hour. You won't be ready by trying to guess when it's coming. You'll be ready by keeping watch, by practicing daily discipleship. The wise in this parable, these wise bridesmaids, they take the long look. They anticipate that the bridegroom's coming might be a long way off, and so they are properly and dutifully prepared. They can live purposefully, they can wait purposefully without fear because they know they've made the proper preparations.
The way to prepare for the end is not going to be to, I hear radio ads sometimes, stock up on gold, build a bunker underneath your house, stock it with things that you can, survive the zombie apocalypse or whatever else might come. But the way to be most ready for the end of your own life or of the world's life will be, walking daily with Jesus as Lord. There was a time where John Wesley was asked what he would do if he knew the Lord would return at this time tomorrow. I mean, if you knew that Jesus' return, this day of glory and power, was going to happen tomorrow, what would you do today? What would you do tonight? Wesley's response was, I would go to bed, and I would sleep. I would wake up in the morning and go on with my work, for I would want him to find me doing what he had appointed. That's a wonderful and sort of counterintuitive answer, but I think it's right in step with Jesus' teaching in this parable. If I am already walking in step with Jesus, if I'm living out the calling and callings he's given me, then I would want to be found doing the things he has called me to do when he returns. In a similar way, there's a story told, maybe some of you will have heard it before, Neil Planiga tells it in his little book, Engaging God's World. It's a story that takes place in Connecticut in May of 1780. And for a couple of days, there had been a fairly strange darkness that fell over the whole New England area. And on that particular day, it grew especially bad. And by noon, it was impossible to read or write, even if you were sitting right by a window. The members of the legislature, the state council, were working on that day. And it had been dim for a few days, and it got especially dark. It had also smelled kind of smoky. If you remember last summer when we had some smoky days of Canadian wildfires, scientists have since gone back and seen that there were some raging Canadian wildfires right around that time, which seems to have contributed to this. But there may have been other factors too. Maybe you combine something like that day of smokiness in the air and a dimness in the sky and then throw in like a solar eclipse. And it got so dark that everybody got really afraid. They thought this might be the end. The day of judgment had come. The end of the world was nigh. But one of the legislators named Abraham Davenport spoke up. Because some were saying, we ought to adjourn this session. We can't meet. We can't work. We ought to all, flee, go home, whatever we have to do. But he said this. He said, I am against adjournment. The day of judgment is either approaching or it is not. If it is not, there's no cause for adjournment. And if it is, I choose to be found doing my duty. I wish, therefore, that candles may be brought. So they brought out candles, and they lit them, and they went back to work on what many of them feared was or would be the day of judgment, that they might be found crafting meaningful laws that helped ensure justice, that helped order society, that they would be found doing that even on the day of judgment. Maybe, I like to think, that maybe the thought of the possible day of judgment maybe even influenced some of their votes that day. They thought, maybe I shouldn't pursue this means of personal gain, or simply squabble with my own little private, but maybe I should pursue the common good in light of the fact that Jesus may show up and assess what we're doing here. Light the candles. Do the work. This seems to me to be a good summary of the heart of Jesus' parable. Ready or not? Well, be ready by keeping watch and keeping on keeping watch. Don't fret about the timing. Know what Christ has called you to, of a life of full discipleship and following him as Lord. Keep watch, be prepared. Trim your wicks with faithful prayer and daily discipleship. Fill your lamps with the oil of love and good deeds done in Jesus' name. Go for that long obedience in the same direction. Call others to do the same. Will you be ready or will you be not? Well, that will be reflected in how you live your lives. Ready or not, Jesus might say to us, here I come. Let's go to him in prayer. God, our Father, we give you thanks again this day for your word and your word made flesh. We give you thanks for Jesus, for all that he embodied and said and did, and for what he taught, especially today through this parable. Lord, help us not to get too caught up in what strike us as odd details and then miss the heart of the message, this call to keep watch, to be ready, to have with Jesus not only a momentary flash of experience or a simple outward confession that we are Christians or that Jesus is Lord, but that true living of Jesus' lordship, humbling ourselves under him, seeking to follow his ways of teaching in all things. Lord, help us to keep our lamps trimmed and burning to bring all our lives, all our days, each moment, under his gracious, kind, and strong lordship. We thank you today for Jesus' word. His words of caution, warning, but also his words to us of tremendous grace and promise. We hear him calling and telling us that the day will come, that he is coming. So we thank you for Jesus, and we pray all this in his name. Amen. Our first response to that will be in song, although we respond to Jesus' words with our whole lives. This song prompts us to consider that the way all of our days and all of our tomorrows, today's and tomorrow's, can be brought into fellowship with Christ. So let's rise as able as we sing together. Friends, as we prepare to leave, an invitation to hang around, stick around, interact, have a chance to have a cup of coffee together. If you're a guest with us especially, we're delighted you're here and hope to have a chance to know you and have you get to know us a bit. Likewise, if you're worshiping with us on the live stream, if there's any ways we can be in prayer for you, please reach out to us. For those of you who are here in person, there will be an elder at the prayer room in the back there who's available to pray with you if you would like after the service. But go then into this day, into this new week, this day and all of our tomorrows, knowing that we go to live this life of daily discipleship and faithfulness, not in our own strength and resources alone, but with the help, the power, and the blessing of Jesus, by the presence of his Spirit. So receive his word of blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his abiding peace. Amen and amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Savior, all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Joyful confession, I am his own, following Jesus. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission. At rest, I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, kept in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.